Hello, welcome to this week's Sparta Live webinar. Γεια σας, καλώς ορίσατε στη σειρά Sparta Live. I'm Chrysanthi Gallou, Associate Professor of Aegean Archaeology at the University of Nottingham and Director of the University Center for Spartan and Peloponnesian Studies. Today's webinar, which is the last one of the series for 2020, will be delivered by a dear colleague, Dr Elena Franchi, who will discuss whether the Spartans were historically warlike or prudent. The talk will take us back on the eve of the Peloponnesian War, where it seems there were two competing memories on Sparta at war. One portraying Spartans as more πολεμικοί, belligerent, the other as more σώφρονες, prudent. And we'll focus on the purposes these memories may have served. It is indeed our great pleasure to welcome Dr. Franchi, an assistant professor of ancient Greek history at the University of Trento and assistant manager of the Laboratory of Science of Antiquity of the Center for Advanced Studies in the Humanities there. Elena's research interests include ancient Greek history, archaeology and epigraphy, with a special focus on interstate relations, frontier wars, ethnogenesis and memory studies. Her research also focuses on historiography, especially on Herodotus and Thucydides, on speeches, especially Demosthenes and Aeschines, the periegic genre, especially Pausanias and Plutarch. Elena received her PhD at the University of Geneva in 2008 with a thesis on the frontier wars between Spartans and Argives and the connected rituals. From 2011 to 2013, she was a von Humboldt Fellow at the University of Freiburg in Germany. In 2012, she got a Europa Fellowship to join the archaeological excavations in Kalapodi and in Delphi. In 2016, she published her first monograph in German with the title, I've translated it, The Conflicts Between Thessalians and Phocians, War and Identity in the Greek Culture of Remembrance of the 4th Century. In the following years, she received the National Scientific Habilitation as Associate Professor. Since 2011, she has been disseminating the results of her fascinating research at a wide range of international conferences and symposia. We had been very lucky to host one of her talks in our conferences as well. And she's currently writing a monograph on the border wars between Argos and Sparta. Elena, welcome to Sparta Live. The stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Chrysanthi. So, first of all, I would like to thank Chrysanthi Gallou and all the staff at the Center for Spartan and Peloponnesian Studies for inviting me to speak in the Live Sparta series. It is a honor for me to share my reflection with you at the only center in the world specifically dedicated to Spartan studies. One of the elements in the Spartan mirage was certainly its militarism. I use the term militarism in a broad sense, taking into account the observation made by Steve Hutchinson. Militarism is a much debated facet of Spartan culture, and influential scholars have addressed this topic, and many important pages have already been written on it. It is in the framework of these studies that today I would like to analyze a minor, but maybe significant aspect of this militarism, a readiness to swiftly intervene militarily. So a warlike, but not exactly warlike quality, the quality of πολεμικοί in the sense of belligerent. Next slide. I know they are not synonyms. After all, we will go into the meaning of these words in ancient Greek, σώφρονες, εύβουλοι, and so on. How πολεμικοί in this sense were the Spartans? How warlike? Did those famous Spartan warriors who in our imaginary are determined to win or to die go into battle as soon as the opportunity arose? Actually, some ancient sources portray them as cautious and wise, σώφρονες or εύβουλοι. In the modern imaginary, instead, the Spartans are portrayed as eager to fight, greedy for blood. Admittedly, even this representation is not entirely without basis in the ancient sources, but less widespread than you might think. Well, today I would like to take a closer look at this polarity, or double nature, namely this fact that the Spartans seem sometimes warlike and sometimes cautious. The inspiration for this analysis came to me from a famous Thucydidean section. And it is the next slide. Thank you. The Tessares Logoi, the four speeches that Corinthian Athenians, King Archidamus, and the ephorus Stenelaidas held on the eve of the Peloponnesian War, deciding whether to even wage this war. The Peloponnesian War is, roughly speaking, a war between Spartan allies and Athens and allies. I say this for the less experienced among you. And this is a well-known section. And if I go through it again, it is only to focus on the points that are crucial to the problem I would like to analyze together with you today, namely the πολεμικοί εύβουλοι polarity, assuming it is a polarity. Later on, we will question this point. In fact, it seems to me that all four speeches address this theme, evoking significant memories. Some about warlike, in the sense of belligerent Spartans, others about cautious Spartan. After giving an account of several occasions when the Athenians interfered in the interest of some of the cities allied with Sparta, in particular Corinth, Thucydides reports that the Spartans summoned those among the Peloponnesian allies who felt they had been harmed by the Athenians and invited them to present their arguments to the assembly of the Spartans. This is 432 BC. The Corinthians spoke last. Next slide. Thank you. After evoking the inexperience of the Spartans in foreign policy, they accused the Spartans of having remained inactive in the face of the growing power and increasingly offensive attitudes of the Athenians. They claimed, the Corinthians claimed, the Spartans defended themselves not by force, but only with intentions. It is the next slide. Next slide. Thank you. Yes. Benjamin Jovetz and Thomas Hobbes translations are among the resources available online that are invaluable in times of pandemic. Although they are known as brave people, the Lacedaemonians now hesitate. And this hesitation has precedents, which the Corinthians claim to remember well. We know epistametza. Even during the Greek-Persian Wars, the Spartans would only make a move once the enemy had arrived at the gates of the Peloponnese. Next slide. I know that these are just some of the battle fought in the context of the Persian Wars, and I choose these because they are explicitly evoked by the Corinthians or because they are crucial to the problem we are analyzing. But back to what the Corinthians say. Now, as then, instead of attacking, the Lacedaemonians prefer to repel once attacked, a characteristic that the Corinthians highlight in their discourse also by recalling past events. The topic of the Lacedaemonians' hesitation is then further elaborated by contrasting them to the Athenians, whose ability to undertake projects, welcome new experiences, and move away from their homeland is underlined. The Lacedaemonians, by contrast, the Corinthians say, have an antiquated attitude. It is the next slide. Old-fashioned, in Jowett's translation. And the Lacedaemonians, the Corinthians say, are only interested in their own of defense. The Corinthian discourse ends with an appeal that once again brings up events from the past. The forefathers left a strong Peloponnese. The Peloponnese was strong thanks to the leadership of the Lacedaemonians, who now have to prove they are up to the challenge. Thucydides then goes on to inform us that the echo of these speeches also has reached Athenian ambassadors who were in Sparta for other reasons, and who then ask for the floor to defend themselves against accusations made by the Corinthians. It is the next slide. Thank you. The Athenians stress the need to reflect and to decide calmly. In short, in the words of the Corinthians, to hesitate. Among the arguments put forward by the Athenians, they cite facts about the past that are known to the elders, but not known by the youth. The Athenians also recall the need to remember the wars against the Persians. In these wars, the Athenians showed courage for the benefit of all Greeks, in particular the Lacedaemonians. Next slide. So I let you read by yourself so that my barbarian pronunciation does not interfere with your comprehension of this passage. So we can go maybe to the next slide. The reference is not only to the Battle of Marathon or Salamis, but also to the decades following the Battle of Plataea, events that have as their Spartan protagonist Pausanias, while Athens is increasingly engaged in the Aegean. In the light of all these events and the allegedly legitimate ways in which the Athenians constituted their empire, the Lacedaemonians are invited to think calmly and make a wise decision. Next slide. At the end of the speech made by the Athenians, the Lacedaemonians have a meeting among themselves. And the majority believe that the Athenians are guilty and that it is necessary to go to war soon. Next slide. The king Archidamus takes the floor. Archidamus, and I quote Thucydides, who had a reputation as an intelligent and wise man. Next slide. Where I have also the Greek, xynetos, dokon einai kai sophron. His first words appeal to the experience he has had of many wars. Empeiros eimi, polon polemon. Those who assess wisely have understood that the war looming is of considerable importance and that preparation is needed for such a conflict. A conflict that is not comparable to wars waged in the Peloponnese against neighbors, both because it takes place in a faraway territory and because the enemies have extensive financial means as well as decidedly superior alliances. Next slide. Okay. Only after appropriate preparation, after some 2 or 3 years, he says, would it even be possible to wage war. And this would only be necessary if by this time the Athenians have still not heeded the embassies sent to dissuade them from disturbing the Corinthian and other Peloponnesian allies of Sparta, or have not given up in light of the Spartans' increased military preparation. Slowness and hesitation, to bradu kai mellon, are not defects, Archidamus says, but instead prevent a reckless attack, not bolstered by adequate preparation. Sparta must show shrewd wisdom, or a modesty proceeding upon judgment, σώφρονες εμφρον, not easy to translate, as she has already done in the past, as Sparta has already done in the past. In fact, it is thanks such modesty that Sparta has always been a free and rather famous city. In his final plea, Archidamus again brings up the Spartan past. This kind of behavior was handed down to the Spartans of his generation by their fathers, and he and his contemporaries have always practiced it profitably, as they should continue to do without pressure to make hasty decisions. After reporting the words of Archidamus, Thucydides moves on to the speech by Stenelaidas. Next slide, thank you. Who also recalls the Persian Wars, but takes a different perspective from both the Athenians and Archidamus and has different objectives in mind. Next slide. But the point that is most of interest to us is when he overturns the argument of Archidamus and the Athenian ambassadors. Deciding in a manner worthy of Sparta, axios tes Spartis, implies voting for war without wasting time before the power of the Athenians grows further. Now, as it is well known, what happens next is that the Spartans vote in favor of Stenelaidas' proposal, but in fact, they carry out Archidamus' strategy, because months pass in preparation before they invade Attica. And Archidamus is not a pacifist. If anything, he advocates a wait-and-see approach, an anti-interventionist who tries to avoid military intervention in every way, but who does not completely deny the usefulness of military intervention. He advocates a wait-and-see approach and therefore is reluctant to engage in conflict, and is willing to make war only under precise conditions. Today, however, I do not intend to analyze these aspects, or rather I will make them secondary. They are aspects which have already been studied a great deal. Today, I would like to dwell on a point which, as far as I know, has not yet been studied in depth. To put in a very sketchy way, please excuse me, soon we'll zoom in. On the one hand, Archidamus claims that the Spartans have always been prudent and wise. On the other hand, Stenelaidas urged the Spartans to vote in a Sparta-like manner. Both evoke past wars and appeal for continuity. And, as has been noted, both stances are outlined in Spartan code words. In fact, on the one hand, Archidamus not only evokes Persian wars and related facts, most probably other wars, maybe during the Pentecontetia, that young people do not know about, I'm quoting Thucydides, but also continues to focus on what their fathers did, or what their ancestor did, depending on how we understand that expressions. On the other hand, Stenelaidas asks the Spartans to vote in a manner worthy of Sparta. The notion of worthy of necessarily implies a comparison with the past. It is obvious, but still useful, to draw attention to the fact that worthy of Sparta most probably means worthy of what Sparta has done in the past. Worthy of the fame of Sparta, a fame that Sparta has earned in the past. In short, for Stenelaidas, attacking Athens mean reasserting an attitude already put in place in the past by the Spartans. On closer inspection, it seems that Archidamus and Stenelaidas are talking about two different pasts of the same city, or even about two different cities. But were the Spartans actually prone to wait and see, or were they interventionists in the past? Prudent or warlike? It seems to me that at the time when Thucydides and Herodotus, too, wrote, there were two competing memories on Spartans at war. One memory portrayed them as cautious, the other as warlike. Both attitudes characterized the Spartans and were traditional in Sparta. In fact, both Thucydides and Herodotus, who wrote in the second half of the 5th century, mentioned situations where the Spartans took a more wait-and-see approach and others where they had a more interventionist approach. Let's look at some of them. Next slide. Memories on prudent Spartans. As I said, I will now present a selection of episodes narrated by Herodotus and Thucydides in which the Spartans were hesitant and cautious, or instead interventionist. In some cases, these were military intervention beyond the Isthmus of Corinth, specifically in Attica. Let's start with the prudent and wise Spartans, or hesitant, depending on the point of view. It is the next slide. Herodotus 6, 108-3. When the Plataeans were threatened by the Thebans and asked the Spartans king Cleomenes for help, Cleomenes advised them to turn to the Athenians, who, being closer, could have guaranteed more effective protection. Next slide. This case is particularly significant because the protagonist is Cleomenes, a king who is known to have been more enterprising than others, as we shall see, but who was also the protagonist of a situation in which he interpreted the model of the renouncing Spartan as not very warlike, as in the next two episodes we shall examine. But before moving on to the next case, we need to highlight how Herodotus comments on Cleomenes' advice in this case. Herodotus says, and I'm quoting Herodotus, "The Lacedaemonians gave this advice not so much out of goodwill toward the Plataeans as wishing to cause trouble for the Athenians with the Boeotians." So in this case, according to Herodotus, their reluctance to fight is a fiction that hides a different strategy. But let's move to the next episode and to the next slide. Herodotus 5:50, Cleomenes again. Cleomenes himself, a few years later, replied to Aristagoras, who had gone to Sparta to ask for support during the Ionian Revolt, that it would not be acceptable for the Lacedaemonians to make a proposal involving a commitment in such distant lands. Aristagoras was the leader of the Ionian Revolt, that is the uprising of the Greek cities of Asia Minor against the Persian rule in 499. This is a very famous passage, often cited as an emblematic of the Spartans' reluctance to act outside the Peloponnese. It is important at this point to focus on one aspect that we only touched on fleetingly before. In fact, one could object that reluctance or willingness to undertake a military campaign do not necessarily correspond to wait and see or interventionist approaches to a military campaign. Next slide. I have thought about it and concluded that these risks being a sophistication that does not go so far. If one is reluctant, he can still hold attitudes toward action that range from immobility at one extreme to wait and see and then attack battle at the other extreme. It is certainly true that if one is reluctant, one is not necessarily taking a wait-and-see stance. But it is also true that if one wishes to wait and see, one is very likely to be reluctant, or at least tend in that direction. Similarly, if one is willing or even eager to wage war, one tends to be interventionist. It is true that being interventionist does not necessarily imply being eager to make war, especially if a rhetoric that war is necessary has been built up. But it is also true that even in the context of such rhetoric regarding the necessity for war, a wait-and-see approach hardly urges one to intervene immediately without the slightest hesitation, as Stenelaidas proposes. It is for this reason that I believe it is appropriate to group together the cases in which, according to the ancient evidence, the Spartans took a wait-and-see approach and or were reluctant. In both cases, assuming that there are separate cases, we are dealing with precedents to which Archidamus could refer when he incited the Spartans to act as their fathers had done. But let's go back to the review of our cases. We are still talking about the memories of the wait-and-see Spartans. So, next slide. Thank you. On the eve of the Battle of Marathon, when the Athenians asked the Spartans for help by sending the aerodrome of Pheidippides, the Spartans, let it be known that they cannot leave because it is the ninth day since the beginning of the month and the full moon has not yet arrived. Regardless of whether the delay of the Spartans at Marathon is real, invented, or just exaggerated, each of these hypotheses has been put forward by modern scholars, the episode bears witness to the fact that both when Herodotus writes and when the tradition that the historian transmits were created and shaped, Spartan reluctance to intervene beyond the isthmus, expressed as hesitation or delay, was considered plausible. A similar reluctance seems to play a role in the case of the Spartan attitude on the eve of Thermopylae, when the Spartans sent only 300 men led by Leonidas because the festival of the Carnia is in progress, while the Peloponnesian allies are prevented from coming by the Olympic Games. And reluctance or delay are also significant factors in narratives on the Spartan delay at the Battle of Plataea, where the festival of the Hyacinthia is said to hold them back. I do not intend to deal with the Persian War here as a subject on which I am not an expert, but in the light of the Thesaurus Logoi of our four speeches in Thucydides, these episodes make me wonder, who knows what Archidamus thought of these delays in the Persian Wars? Perhaps what appeared as delays to Herodotus seemed to him like wise prudence, σώφρονες εἰμφρον. Next slide. And again, next slide, let us move on to the next episode, the attitude of the Spartans during the Pentecontetia. It is the period between the Battle of Plataea in 479 to the start of the Peloponnesian War in 432 BC, would have been similar. Thucydides writes that although the Lacedaemonians realize that the Athenians are strengthening their empire, they offer no opposition, since they do not want to enter into wars unless there is a need to do so. This is also confirmed by the last episode on the reluctant Spartans we will deal with here. In 456 BC, when the Athenians are engaged in Egypt, the Persian king Artaxerxes, who has interest in Egypt, of course, sends an otherwise unknown Megabazus to ask Sparta for help. Megabazus should have convinced the Peloponnesian to invade Attica in order to cause the withdrawal of the Athenians from Egypt, but the Spartans do not accept his invitation. They are reluctant. Next slide. Memories about interventionist Spartan or belligerent. In Herodotus, however, there are also episodes that would seem to better support Stenelaidas' proposal. These are episodes to which he might have referred when he specifies that it is necessary to act in a manner worthy of Sparta. These episodes are fewer in number, but somehow more significant because they involve invasions in Attica. Next slide. Encouraged by the Oracle of Delphi, the Spartan king Cleomenes intervenes in Athens to provoke a political upheaval. He demands to expel from Athens the impious man, sacrilegious, it is Herodotus 572, and the Athenian leader Cleisthenes leaves. Cleomenes shows up in Athens with a military contingent and expels 700 Athenian families, suggested to him by his Athenian ally, Isagoras. Herodotus specifies that Cleomenes' incursion will occur not much later, μετά ουδέν εσσον, therefore without delay. He means not long after the request to banish the sacrilegious. In short, Cleomenes, in this specific case, acts promptly, without any downtime, without waiting for strategic reasons, for example, to see if the situation can be resolved through diplomacy. In fact, he intervenes with a military force, even if not a great one, husyn megale cheiri, and leaves no room for negotiation. Next slide. Cleomenes' reaction to the Athenian offences in words and deeds was also swift and imposing. The king would have gathered the whole Peloponnesian army, intending to impose the tyrant Isagoras on Athens. This was the second of two famous attempts. In support of the Spartans, the Boeotians occupied the two villages of Attica, Oinoe and Hysie, and the Chalcidians raided lands in Attica. Here the theme, the topic of the invasion of Attica is central. The Athenians decided to first face the Lacedaemonians who were in Eleusis. This was followed by the famous debacle by the Corinthians. I don't think it could be said that on the occasion of these actions in Attica, Cleomenes was hesitant or took a wait-and-see approach. I will not go so far as to say that Stenelaidas had these Attica invasions by Cleomenes in mind when he said, vote in a manner worthy of Sparta. But perhaps he was at least thinking of similar attitudes or events. It is important to stress that the topic of the invasions in Attica was very significant for Herodotus, and perhaps also for the traditions he shaped. But that is not all. Even the memories of these invasions of Attica themselves play an important role. After describing the failure of the enterprise by the Peloponnesian led by Sparta, Herodotus remembers that, and I'm quoting Herodotus, this was the fourth time that the Dorians entered Attica, having entered twice to make war there and twice for the good of the Athenian people. Here, Herodotus is reflecting on all the significant occasions on which the Spartans invaded Attica in archaic times. And indeed, considering that his histories were written and read during the Peloponnesian Wars too, the mention of this Dorian invasion was more topical than ever after the invasions of Attica the Spartans led once the Peloponnesian War has begun, that is in 431, 430 and 428 BC. Among other things, let me note that it was in those very years that the four speeches reported by Thucydides would have been given. The problem of the chronology of the composition of Herodotus' work and the chronology of the composition of Thucydides' works are debated, But I think that if we say that both works were composed over the same 30, 40 years, we take into account most of the chronology proposed by scholars. Next slide. So maybe we can say, trying to be cautious, that within 30 or 40 years, therefore less than a generation, Herodotus recalls the most significant invasion in Attica before the Persian Wars in his histories. Archidamus and Stenelaidas give speeches to convince the Spartan whether to invade Attica or not. Thucydides puts the speeches in writing, reworked to a lesser or greater extent. The invasions in Attica in the early years of the Peloponnesian War take place, and Herodotus and Thucydides' audiences are led to remember the ancient invasions and to reflect on the present invasions. It follows that this memory of hesitation and the importance of timely action on the occasion of an invasion in Attica are particularly significant. Thucydides himself underlines the relevance of the memory of Dorian invasion in Attica and of the Spartans' attitude to war in Attica. As it is well known, and as we have already mentioned, in these crucial years, the Peloponnesians invaded Attica almost every year, 431, 430, 428, and so on. On the occasion of one of these invasions, the second, the Athenians hoped that the Peloponnesian would not advance beyond Eleusis and Thria, two villages in Attica. Next slide. Why? Because, says Thucydides, they remember well the invasion of Plistonax. It is Thucydides 2:21, Mnemenoi. Thucydides then recounts how this antecedent remains alive in the memory of the Athenians. In fact, shortly after the Euboean defection from the Athenian League led by Athens, we are in 436, the Lacedaemonians were preparing to invade Attica, and led by the Spartan king Pleistoanax, were to arrive as far as Eleusis and Thria. After plundering the territory, the planet to withdraw. And according to Thucydides, the Athenians would remember this almost 30 years later on the occasion of another incursion in Attica. In short, being timely or hesitant during a military invasion in Attica was a hot and variously memorialized topic. So, to sum up, it seems to me that at the time when Archidamus and Stenelaidas gave their speeches, and when the speeches were put into writing with a degree of creativity that does not interest us here, there were two competing memories about the willingness and speed of the Spartans to intervene in war. One memory portrayed them as reluctant, taking a wait-and-see attitude, another as more interventionist. The first portrayal was very probably predominant, and the episodes remembered are more numerous. That is, there are more cases in which the Spartan waited, hesitated. I'm wondering, however, if the Spartans were both πολεμικοί and at the same time εύβουλοι. In some cases, they intervened without hesitation. It is to these cases that Stenelaidas refers when he invites the Spartan to act in a manner worthy of Sparta. Incidentally, we would expect individuals such as Stenelaidas and allies of Sparta, such as the Corinthians, to describe the Spartans as hesitant and late to act in episodes where the Spartan adopted a wait-and-see strategy. those who waited could be accused of being hesitant or late. But perhaps I'm going too far. Next slide. I forgot this slide. And the last slide, thank you. Thank you for your attention, and now turn over to Chrysanthi.
Thank you, Elena, very much for this very engaging talk. Shall I take the privilege of host and ask you a question? You use the concept of competing memories in your talk. In what context was it introduced, and to what extent can it be used in reference to ancient Greece? Thank you.
Thank you, Chrysanthi. This is a very interesting topic. Actually, the concept of competing memories was introduced not in ancient history, but more in contemporary history. There is an important book by Badner, Remaking America, Public Memory, Commemoration and Patriotism in the 20th Century, Princeton 1992. Where the concept of competing memories and vernacular memories, local memories, is used in a very interesting way. But there is a difference, of course, with memories in ancient Greece. Whereas in Bodnar's book and as in other books about contemporary history, competing memories are described as top-down memories or bottom-up memories. So we can have top-down memories, that is memories monopolized by a summit of power, top-down, and on the other side, competing memories which are bottom-up, and are widespread and shaped by lower layers of the population, for example. This is not the case of ancient Greece, because numerous studies have shown that in Greece, cultural memory is not monopolized by a summit of power, by a position of power, but widespread and often co-built by different groups. So we have to take into account this difference, but beyond the difference, I think that the concept of competing memories is interesting, because it allows us to understand why, for example, in this case, we have two different images of the Spartans: prudent in memories about some episodes, and more warlike in other episodes. Were they the same people? Yeah, they were, but we have different memories about them, and most probably they are competing memories. And in the speeches by Archidamus and Stenelaidas, these competing memories become the focus of the speech. Should we have a wait and see approach, or be more interventionist? Mm-hmm. How were our fathers?
Good. Thank you. Thank you very, very much, Elena. We have opened the Q&A for the audience questions. So I will turn over to Matt, who is here as in every episode, to run to manage Q&A. Matt, over to you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chrysanthi, and thank you very much, Elena, for really fun and interesting talk tonight. So the first question I've got here is about, was avoiding fighting during festivals quite widespread in ancient Greece? And were there enough festivals during the year that it was always a plausible excuse to avoid battles because of them?
I'm not an expert, but I think that, during festival, it was not allowed to wage war, not only for the Spartans, but also for other polis. But in this specific case, it is interesting that in the case of the Spartans, it happens very often that they are they are busy with a festival. So some scholars assumed that this topic of the delays because of a festival is not invented, but maybe exaggerated to explain an attitude of the Spartans, which are described as not so warlike as we would expect, especially if we take into account the modern image of the Spartans, which portrays them as very warlike and greedy for blood.
Thank you very much. Am I right in remembering, is there an episode where the Argives try to claim there's a festival and so the Spartans can't invade? Or have I got that one wrong?
You mean in the border wars between Argives and Spartans?
Yes.
I think you are hinting not to a festival as an episode in which a festival has a role as a peace mean, but to the Battle of Sepeia, maybe, because after the battle, the Argives founded a festival. They founded a festival to commemorate the death, and yes, the Spartans were the winners, but they commemorate the death and the aftermath of the battle when the slaves came to power and the women too, according to some sources, for example, Pausanias, we were talking about, and Plutarch.
Thank you. So another question here just in the Q&A. Do you think it is more appropriate to think about war as a foundation of a collective identity, or is war always a consequence of these identities competing?
I think we don't have to choose between the first idea or the second one. Both are right, but I'm quite convinced that war has a very strong identity foundation power, because it is in a specific situation of war that people of a same community, for example, are induced to stay together, to stay strong, and to feel as members of the same group, and so to make their group identity stronger. I don't know if I replied to the question.
I think that was excellent. So just picking up on something you said about this prudence or sophrosyne from Archidamus, was this something that was specific to the Spartans, or was it all over Greece?
Yeah, the sophrosyne ephorus. I think that one might have the temptation to think that the sophrosyne is a typical Spartan virtue. But at a closer look, it is maybe more safe to say that it is an aristocratic value in archaic time. And if I correctly understood the arguments put forward by Noreen Humble in his article about the sophrosyne of the Spartans, the sophrosyne is, for example, cited also by ancient sources in connection with the Athenians. And even in Thucydides, it is not typical of the Spartans. There is only one passage where it is typical of the Spartans, but in this case, not only of the Spartans, but also of the inhabitants of the Isle of Chios. And in Herodotus, we have a passage which is 474, I think, where it is said that the Spartans are sophrones, the sophrosyne is typical of the Spartans, but in this case it is limited to the manner of speaking and of not speaking too much. In this sense, they are characterized by sophrosyne, but it is all in this limited case. It seems, I think that Humble is correct in arguing that sophrosyne in archaic time is a more aristocratic value in different polis, and Sparta is not so different from the other polis from this perspective too. And only later on, maybe in Athenian circles of intellectual, an image was shaped where the Spartans were characterized by σώφρονες and from, for example, in this case, Archidamus.
Wonderful. Okay, the next question in here is, how did areas under Spartan control, and perhaps we might ask also cities in the Spartan alliance, interact with these memories of Sparta? So were they, did they ever try and kind of create a break in their own timeline to preserve their own identity? Or did they, or how did they try and manipulate these two memories?
Thank you for this question. It is a very interesting question too. I think it is very difficult to grasp the Spartan contribution in shaping this memory. Because as it is well known, we have really few Spartan sources in archaic times. And we have many Athenian sources about Sparta. So maybe we can say maybe that there is an image on the Spartans, a memory about the Spartans, or more memories about the Spartans that were shaped in an Athenian context, especially in the second half of the 5th century. But we are not able to say if the Spartan contributed to construct these memories. There is an important paper by Paul Cartledge and Paula Debnar where they argue that maybe Thucydides may have had a contact to Spartans and Peloponnesians during his exile, during the Peloponnesian War. And in this occasion, he could have had an access to Spartan memories, in the sense of memories about the Spartans produced by the Spartans. And this is very likely, I think this is very likely, it is also very difficult to show. Yeah,
entirely fair. So I think probably just time for one last question. So perhaps you could tell us, are there any other episodes in the history of Sparta which stand out where there is a debate about war and peace, which is similar to this one between Archidamus and Stenelaidas?
Yeah. There is a very interesting passage by Diodorus, or maybe you say Diodorus. I don't know the right pronunciation, sorry. Diodorus, 1150, in which a very interesting scene is depicted. Etemaridas, who seems Archidamus, is an old man in the assembly of the Spartans, who advise to be to leave hegemony to the Athenians, and his orientation receives more consensus than the proposal put forward by the young to regain hegemony. Here there is the idea of the dual hegemony. And the episode is set by Diodorus in the 60s of the 5th century. And it's very similar to the speeches of Archidamus and Stenelaidas in Thucydides. So we may suspect that this episode was invented or constructed, but maybe in this sense we are going too far. I think in this case, Matteo Zaccarini is right in arguing that this episode is believable, not in its details, but in its perspective, in its general perspective. So we could imagine that in the 60s of the 5th century, there was a debate in Sparta about the dual hegemony. Should we leave the hegemony to the Athenians, or should we regain more hegemony, even over the sea and not only over the land?
Excellent. Well, I think we're close to the end now, so shall I hand back over to Chrysanthi? And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matt, for managing the Q&A. Today, we learned a lot about memories, about the Spartans and memories of the Spartans. But unfortunately, our webinar must come to a close. Elena, thank you for highlighting this aspect of Spartan history and culture in such a vivid and engaging way. Since May 2020, we have hosted 15 webinars that painted a fascinating picture of ancient Sparta. We hope you enjoyed, as audience, our talks as much as we enjoyed running them. We aim to continue our journey back in Spartan history next year with some equally fascinating topics, so stay tuned from February. 2020 has been an extremely challenging year for our world, we all know that. But what it has taught us is that if we come together and work together, we can achieve great things. For us, Sparta Live and our collaboration with the mayor and the city of Sparta has been such an achievement. There are many people we would like to thank for this. First of all, my co-host of the series, Mayor Petros Doukas, and the city of Sparta for their cooperation and great support. A big thank you goes to our esteemed guest speakers for 2020 and to Mrs. Kate Smith, the UK ambassador at Athens. Also, we owe thanks to the Faculty of Arts, the School of Humanities, the Department of Classics and Archaeology, the press office and marketing team at the University of Nottingham, and my colleagues at the Center for Spartan and Peloponnesian Studies, in particular, Professor Bill Kavanagh, Professor Stephen Hodkinson, Dr. Lynn Fotheringham, and Dr. Philip Davies. The series has benefited immensely by the support received from Dr. Anna Wallace, Dr. Hannah Regan, Matt Thompson, Terry Wilmer, Richard Harris, Gabriel Ban, Vicky Morris, Katerina Sanida, and Dimitri Sambatakakis. And please forgive me if I've forgotten anyone. Finally, yet most importantly, many thanks are owed to all of you who attended the series this year. And we definitely look forward to welcoming you back in 2021. But until then, best wishes from all of us for a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. So goodbye for now and stay safe. Αγαπημένοι μας φίλοι και φίλες, σας ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Ραντεβού το 2021. Από όλους εμάς, καλά Χριστούγεννα και καλή χρονιά. Με γεμάτη υγεία, όνειρα, νέα ξεκινήματα. Γεια σας και να είστε όλοι καλά. Goodbye.